He's now in South America with Jerry Rubin.
Any travel status in Chile?
Nothing here, but find out. And locate the operating outpost of Camelot down there. Check with Central Intelligence.
Read me in on Camelot.
Allende's successor.
Didn't know he was due for one so soon.
The Pentagon thinks so. They're upgrading the South American armies, to be sure.
I was very taken by the idea of Allende, and so I remember I suggested to Phil, let's go to Chile for 2 months. And Phil and I went, and, you know, Phil was a complex person. He drank a lot. We got in a lot of fights. We got more fights over the fact that he would drink than anything else, because it's boring for a non-drinker to go have supper with someone and have them have drink a bottle of wine before the meal begins and then to get very aggressive and weird, you know. And Phil was amazing because he has this very sensitive side of his personality that's almost feminine. And then in a second, he'll turn into the most incredible male chauvinist, angry person, and then he'll go right back to being so sensitive and shy you want to just embrace him like a little child.
The heaviest thing I ever did in my life was organizing the Chile show. I was doing a lot of world traveling, and I met Victor Jara, and I told him in public that on October 11th of this year, Barricade Records' first release is Victor Jara.
Victor was a folk hero, a folk singer in Chile. Phil had met him on a trip to Chile that she took with Jerry Rubin several years earlier. Tremendously admired his music, loved his music. Victor was captured right after the coup, was taken to the stadium, and was very severely tortured. And this really spurred Phil on to doing something in honor of Victor. About a week before the event, we were losing $18,000. Sales were terrible, and it was partly because the advertising was very poor. We spent money on advertising, but there was nothing very sexy. An evening with Salvador Allende didn't invite a lot of crowds. When the rumors started that Dylan was probably going to show up, the garden sold out.
Okay, we can cut the star-fucking excitement now. We're here for a political purpose. We're not here to see Bob Dylan. We're here to see Salvador Allende. Salvador Allende was overthrown and murdered in a military coup in Chile headed up by General Augusto Pinochet. Salvador Allende dared to unleash a torrent of reforms in Chile, including the nationalization of several of the American-run copper mines. Now he's slaughtered. Victor Jara, the most famous folk singer in Chile, who was loved by all the people in Chile, was tortured to death in the Santiago Stadium. Now, 10 years ago, we had a semi-military coup right here in the United States when JFK was killed by a right-wing paramilitary squad. Well, the same people who were in charge then are still in charge now. And I guess they're just going to keep killing everybody.
Chile had a big effect on Phil because he really identified with Allende, and I think that when the coup happened, it really motivated Phil and deepened his very wrong view that life doesn't work, because near his death, Phil was an advocate of suicide. I mean, he advocated suicide. And I remember saying to him a number of times, I said, Phil, do you want generations of young people to remember you as Phil Ochs, the great singer, or Phil Ochs, the alcoholic who killed himself because life didn't work out for him?
After the Chile concert, Phil was at a loss for really what to do with his life. At this point, the war was dying. There was no longer a platform for him on the war. He had done his Chilean benefit. And he was no longer committed to his music. He'd sort of given up on his music. He wasn't writing. He felt he had lost his voice. And we all tried to find a place for Phil, to find something that Phil felt that he could put all his energies in, and he had a lot of energies. So I started working for Ramsey Clark, setting up concerts around the state, and I got Phil to do most of them. At each event, it was a little nerve-wracking. You were never quite sure if Phil was going to make it to the concert, and then if he would make it through the concert. But he did, invariably. And most of the people that he was performing to were kids in college who had not grown up listening to Phil. They were listening to heavy rock. And the passion, which they had not experienced in colleges, we had all grown up with that in the 60s, but it wasn't there in the 70s.
I can see them coming. They're training in the mountains, and they speak Chinese. And they spread disease. They want to hurt me. They want to get me. They want to bring me down. Oh, but sometime later, when I feel a little safer, I'll assassinate the president. Take over the government.
We're gonna thrive in. Pretty smart on my part. Goodbye.
The last time we met was at Max's Kansas City, and he was drunk as a skunk there, and we were bloated and everything, and a bit burned out. I was about to take off. I knew I was going underground. Very, very few people, maybe four or five people in the whole country knew. And I was headed to L.A., and I knew he had an apartment there, so I was going to ask him if I could use his apartment for 2 weeks while I recovered from surgery. But so I tried to approach him sort of delicately, and I said, Phil, I'm going to go away. And I didn't say, I didn't come out and say it, you know, and I say, and he'd drift off, and I'd say something, you know, so a little song. As soon as he understood, he, like, threw the glass of beer on the floor and started jumping up and down on the glass, and I didn't exactly think he was the best person to kind of have in an underground network and everything. It was kind of a sad image I had of him as I, that was the last, you know, image I had of him. I took off a couple weeks later.
Hello, hello, hello. Is there anybody home? I only called to say I'm sorry. The drums are in the dawn, and all the voices gone, and it seems that there are no more songs.
Phil always played with the idea of suicide. I mean, you can see it in the songs all the way back to the beginning, and there's constant mentions to suicide throughout. I know with the last conversations we had, I think the biggest reason was the fact that Phil felt he no longer belonged. That when Nixon resigned, that was like the last hate object. That was the last cause.
He lost sight of tomorrow. He was depressed today, and therefore he'd be depressed tomorrow. And he was, his constant, repeated statement was, "Oh my God, Denny, what am I going to do? I'm going to die."
Hey, listen. Bobby says he doesn't want you to come along on the Rolling Thunder tour. Stay home, Phil.
As you know, this is my final performance.
Once I knew a sage who sang upon the stage. He told about the world, his lover. But the ashes of the dream can be found in the magazines. And it seems that there are no more songs.
I first met Phil in 1975. I had just came up from Georgia. He put on a couple of nights of concerts down in Folk City. It was called his Farewell Performances, which he invited me to sing at that. It was like, kind of like my debut in New York. And everyone tried to keep him from drinking during his first set. And it went very well, actually. But by the second set, he had started drinking, and it was pretty much of a disaster. I think many people in the audience were disappointed. He was having trouble remembering some of the words to his songs, and he was doing a lot of songs that people didn't want to hear him do. People wanted to hear Phil do Phil Ochs songs, and he wasn't giving them that.
He was promoting suicide. He was saying, "I want to die." He was telling us that. But there was no, when somebody wants to die, what can you do for that person?
He came in one day, and as far as I know, there was no place in the village that could have served him. But if he felt that he wanted to have a drink, he just come in and bang on it, on the bar, and he says, "Mike, they don't want to give me nothing to drink. Give me a drink." So, as a rule, I never did refuse him. So that's why many times I just give him a little watered down drinks, not to make him get too high. And I give him a drink. Then he wanted another one. Then he started to talk very loud. And I said, "Phil, say, you're here. You're supposed to be my buddy." He says, "Oh, Mike, I'm sorry." He says, "But Donna, you're cheaper. You started, why you don't want to give him another drink?" He started to get very belligerent. So, and he sort of cursed me out, and he grabbed it by my shirt, and so he ripped a part of my shirt. And so I got a little peeve, and I said, "Phil, now I'm going to do the same thing as everybody else did in the village. You just stay out of here." I said, "And don't feel that I'm afraid of you." So I grabbed him by his arm, and I pushed him right out of the door. I said, "Don't come in here," because I said, "I've been treat you like a gentleman." I said, "But you don't act like one now." So he got through the street here, through the door, and he came back near the window. The window here was open. And he looked at me and he says, "Mike Porco," he says, "one of these days if I catch you outside." So I look at him, "What?" So he says, he started smiling, he says, "I'll buy you a drink." So as he said that, I felt so emotional. And I said, "The guy's really, you know, something that I can't do nothing. I kept being mean to him or anything." And a few minutes later, come in and we had a drink together again.
saw Phil.
I feel like I'm going to pass out.
Probably in the early winter of 76. He seemed to be getting much worse. Appeared to be like a schizophrenia or something much more serious than just drinking. You know, it was a much more deep-rooted problem.
Ochs was an amateur. He never made a good record. Well, he was also smart to make bad records on purpose so they have their excuse and they wouldn't kill him. Because, see, he knew that if he couldn't become the Beatles, because if he ever became the Beatles, then they would kill him because he'd be strong and he could stop the war. But if the war is over. So now, the real Phil Ochs can emerge safely. And his name is Train.
He claimed he was Luke Train, and I think later on he became John Train or vice versa. I don't remember. He claimed the mafia was after him.
So Train killed Ochs, and he did it painlessly. In a split second, he was dead. By Phil Ochs. Good riddance. He's still around, of course, for sale from Train.
He walked around needing help, and everybody saw it, and nobody could get him to go for it. People tried. There were a lot of people who tried to help him. Jerry Rubin went out of his way. I mean, he was terrific. We went to see him one time, and he offered to take Phil out to California to a friend of his who was a psychiatrist to have him stay at the guy's house and let the guy help him free and no charge. Phil turned it down. He said, and Jerry even offered to go with him. He said, if you don't want to go alone, I'll stop what I'm doing in New York, and I'll go with you. And he said no. And Jerry even got him once as far as the door of Bellevue. And then he chickened out and he walked away. Couldn't handle it. At that time, he was very manic. He was running around New York doing all kinds of crazy things. But there was no way to stop him. I mean, he was just... It was almost like he had a... It sounds crazy, but like a demon in him. Like he just had to get it out. It was like... He was running like a wild person. And then all of a sudden... I mean, he was getting thrown out of places and nobody wanted to talk to him. Not that I blame the people. I mean... He was in such a crazy way, I wouldn't have wanted him out of my house at that time because he was acting so irrationally. I wouldn't have wanted him around the children.
Came up to my place about a month before he died. And he was in really, really bad shape. And I said, Phil, out. And he said, mm-hmm. And off he went. And that was the last I ever saw him.
Remember the last time I really saw Phil, he was walking down Hudson. We'd gotten him out of jail that weekend, and he had a hoe for some reason. He had a hoe and a spade, a great big old long-handled spade. He's walking down the street dragging the hoe and had the spade over his shovel, the spade over his shoulder, and he was kind of disheveled. He left his guitar with us that time. It was 5 or 6 months before he picked it up. I was out of the country when he picked it up. He needed help, and he had always helped others. He was hard to help, but the tragedy is that there wasn't enough compassion of his kind to reach him when he needed it, and that's an indictment of all of us, I guess.
Finally, when it all blew over and he calmed down, that's when he came out to us. And at that point, it was as though the storm was over and the calm had begun, and the calm just became too calm. And I don't know if he was ashamed of what he had done, because he claimed that he'd lost a lot of friends, but his friends were still around.
The thing he kept repeating in the last conversations was that he felt that basically he always stood for a very tasteful career. It was always like the only way to get results was to do it tastefully. You know, that protest should never be ugly. In fact, one of my favorite expressions of his was that in such an ugly time, the true protest is beauty. And that he felt in the last year that he had become a very ugly, despicable person. And he felt that he had really ruined everything with that manic binge. And he felt that he had done things that were the antithesis of what he had stood for all the years preceding. But I think the main thing was that he just, he didn't have control over his mind. He was so depressed that he couldn't come up with a decision. And he couldn't, he had no opinions. And for somebody as opinionated as Phil, that was it.
I was in Woodstock. I think I picked it up in the New York Times, which is, Phil would have liked that. And I was very shocked, you know. I guess the saddest thing, I miss the guy. I wish he were here now. He'd have a lot of material to be writing about. He'd have so much fun writing about all the stuff going on now. That's the worst part, yeah.
I was in Montreal, I guess, in 76 when I heard the news, so I wrote a song, my first song about it, because they asked me to participate in the benefit, the memorial they were going to have to fill in New York, and I came. I was actually there, I was scared out of my wits, and got all disguised up. Everybody recognized me, though, knew it was me, and paid a tribute to Phil. Now he's gone, left us here to sing a song. What can I say? Battle goes on. I saw him there on Freedom's Trail, singing songs and making bail. We walked along through Georgia's mud, shouting out a racist crud. Now Phil's gone and left us here to sing his song. Can't remember it all, you know.
It's all right.
In the green fields of turning, a baby is born. His cries crease the wind and mingle with the morn. An assault upon the order, the changing of the guard, chosen for a challenge that is hopelessly hard. But the only single sign is the sighing of the stars. But to the silence of distance they are sworn.
Then this overflow of life is crushed into a lie. The gentle soul is ripped apart and tossed into the fire. A smile of rejection at the nearness of the night. Truth becomes a tragedy, limping from the light. The heavens are horrified, they stagger from the sight, and the cross is trembling with desire. They say they can't believe it, it's a sacrilegious shame. Now who would want to hurt such a hero of the game? But you know, I predicted it, I knew he had to fall. How did it happen? I hope his suffering was small. Tell me every detail, I've got to know it all. And do you have a picture of the pain? So dance, 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 teach us to be true. Come dance, 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 'cause we love you.
And the night comes again to the circle-studded sky. The stars settle slowly, in loneliness they lie. Till the universe explodes as a falling star is raised. The planets are paralyzed, the mountains are amazed. But they all glow brighter from the brilliance of the blaze. With the speed of insanity, then he dies.
Now, in case there are any doubts about my position on the war, I've just been informed by KPFK that the war is not over yet. So we'll sing it again. At the risk of being facetious to say sing along, but you better not. This might look like a party meeting. After the song, there'll be a recruiting sergeant out there. For those of you that are tired of anti-war songs, here we go again.
But I ain't marching anymore. It's always the old to lead us to the war, always the young to fall.
they close the missile plant. United Fruit screams at the Cuban shore. Call it peace or call it treason, call it love, call it reason, but I ain't marching anymore. No, I ain't marching anymore. Down an Alabama road, remembering what the Bible told, walking with a letter in his hand, dreaming of another southern land, walking down an Alabama road, and he went by the name of William Moore. Now what are you doing, William Moore? Why the letter in your hand? There's only one southern land, and he went by the name of William Moore. What price the glory of one man? What price the glory of one man? What price the hopes? What price the dreams? And what price the glory of one man? Remembering what his grandfather done, fought for the South in 61. 100 years have passed by since then. Now a Moore is fighting for the South again, remembering what his grandfather done. Remembering the time in World War II and the South Pacific island that he knew. Remembering the young men that he killed and the praying that the guns of hate be still. Remembering the time in World War II. What price the glory of one man? What price the glory of one man? What price the hopes? What price the dreams? And what price the glory of one man? And they shot him on the Alabama road, forgot about what the Bible told. They shot him with that letter in his hand, as though he were a dog and not a man. They shot him on the Alabama road. Did you say it was a shame when he died? Did you say he was a fool because he tried? Did you wonder who had fired the gun? Did you know that it was you that fired the gun? Did you say it was a shame when he died? What price the glory of one man? What price the glory of one man? What price the hopes? What price the dreams? And what price the glory of one man? Walking down an Alabama road.
Ready?